Resources Study IPB University. Thank you very much for our good collaboration. Special thanks go to International Collaborative Office, IPB University, and USA through program Peer Bionesia for the contribution to funding the seminar. Finally, thank you to all of you. Thank you for valuable participation and contribution at this seminar. And may this seminar be successful and enjoyable. Stay safe and keep healthy. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much, Dr. Anjumra, for the warm welcome from Embryo IPB. Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to invite the Dean of Faculty of Fisheries and Marine Science to deliver his remark. For Professor Ferdinand Yulianda, time is yours.
Okay, thank you, Mbak Alia. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. The Honorable Minister of Fisheries and Marine Affairs of Republic of Indonesia, Pak Sakti Wahyu Trenggono, and so at the same time as the keynote speaker, the Honorable Director of IPB University, represented by Professor Dodi Rahmat, Vice Rector for International Affairs, Collaboration and Alumni Relations. The Honorable Invited Speakers, Dr. Hemi Yumi, Mai Izuru, Fisheries Research Station, Kyoto University, Japan. Professor Paul Barber, Department of Ecology and Evolutionary Biology, UCLA. Dr. Victor Ph. Niki Julu from Indonesian Horizon Conservation Foundation. Dr. Margaret Kromlis, Institute of Aquaculture, Stirling, University of Stirling, UK. Professor Yoshihiro Ochiai, Tohoku University, Japan, and also Professor Dr. Mala Nurilmala from Faculty of Fisheries and Marine Science, IPB University, and the honorable attendees of the conference. Praise and gratitude to the God that we were given the opportunity to attend the seminar this morning in good health. Let me begin by giving you a warm welcome to International Seminar on Marine Biodiversity, Utilization, Conservation, and Management. This event was organized by the Center of Excellence, Embryo, Enhancing Marine Biodiversity Research in Indonesia, Faculty of Fisheries and Marine Sciences, IPB. In collaboration with the international partnership, namely the Maizuru Fisheries Research Station, Kyoto University, Japan, and Tohoku University, Japan, and the national partnership, namely BRSDM, KAPE, Ministry of Marine Affairs and Fisheries, USAID, Bionesia, Community Indonesian Ecology, Indonesian Water Product Processing Society, and the Center of for Study of Coastal and Ocean Resources, PKSPL IPB. This activity is also the beginning of a series of events for the 59th anniversary of the Faculty of Fisheries and Marine Sciences. The Faculty of Fisheries and Marine Science has always been consistent in the encouraging progress in the fisheries and marine sector. This activity has the term bolstering the health of our ocean and ensuring the sustainable use of marine bioresources. I believe that this seminar can be a platform for knowledge transfer and idea exchange foster research collaboration, national and international researcher, identify knowledge gap, and prioritize research areas in the scope of marine biodiversity. Utilization, conservation, and management. Train young scientists and environmental practitioners and solicit expert advice on practical issues related to tropical marine biodiversity conservation and fisheries management. I would like to say one more on behalf of this seminar organizer, welcome. It's great to see so many of you here. Enjoy this seminar. Thank you. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you so much, Professor Ferdinand Yulianda, for the amazing welcoming mark. Ladies and gentlemen, next I would like to humbly invite the Vice Rector of UB University to deliver his opening remark for Professor Dodik Ridho Nur Rahmat. And it's yours.
Thank you very much. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. The honorable keynote speakers, Engineer Sakti Wahyu Trenggono, the Minister of Marine Affairs and Fisheries of the Republic of Indonesia, the honorable invited speakers, Professor Yoshihiro Ochiya from Tohoku University, Japan, Dr. Henmi Yumi, Maizuru Fisheries Research Station, Kyoto University, Japan, Dr. Margaret Kumlis, Institute of Aquaculture, Stirling, University of Stirling, UK, Dr. Victor P.H. Niki Julu, Yayasan Konservasi Cakrawala Indonesia, YKCI, Professor Ferdinand Yuniandra, the Dean of the Faculty of Fisheries and Marine Sciences, IBB University Bogor, Professor Mala Nurmala, the Department of Aquatic Products Technology, Faculty of Fisheries and Marine Sciences, IBB University, Professor Aryo Damar, Department of Aquatic Resources Management, of Fisheries and Marine Sciences, and Advisory Board Member of Coastal Marine Resources Studies, IBB University, and the Center for Coastal and Marine Research Studies of IBB University. The host, Dr. Reiji Masuda, the Director of the Kyoto Fisheries Research Station, Kyoto University, Japan, Dr. Nyoman Radiarta, the BRSDM, KKP, Bapak Adrianus Sembiring, the Director of Biodiversitas Indonesia, Profesor Nurjana, the Director of Masyarakat Pengolahan Hasil Perikanan Indonesia, Dr. John Fitner, the Head of PKSPM IBB University, Profesor Chris Mono, the Director of Masyarakat Indonesia, and Dr. Suhamsah Imran, the Director of Siamio Geotrop. The distinguished guest and the Dean of the Faculty of Schools at IBB University, Professor Dietrich, the Head of the Senate Faculty of Fisheries and Marine Sciences University, and Professor Mulyono S. Baskoro from the Faculty of Fisheries and Marine Science. The Honorable Director of Fisheries and Marine Science, IBB University, Dr. Charles Simanjunta, and Chairman of the International Seminar on Marine Biodiversity Utilization, Conservation, and Management, Dr. Mutia Samira Iskandar. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, a very good morning to all of you. I would like to welcome you all to the International Seminar on Marine Biodiversity Utilization, Conservation, and Management. I would like also express my gratitude to all the keynote speakers who from their respective countries to share knowledge and experiences fields of expertise. I believe that your keynote speech will give significant contribution to all the audience of the conference. Ladies and gentlemen, Indonesia officially holds the presidency on from the 1st December 2021 until the G20 December 2022. Under the Indonesian presidency, the Environment and Climate Sustainability Working Group will discuss issues, particularly initiatives to develop a global biodiversity post-2020, environmental restoration, protection of ecosystem, the illegal, unreported, and related fishing, marine protected areas in Antarctica and also blue ocean vision, marine waste, efficient use of resources, and circular economy. The blue economy policy is in line with the programs of the Ministry of Marine and Fisheries for marine management, rehabilitation of coastal ecosystems, disaster mitigation, climate change adaptation, and conservation management. Marine biodiversity, food security, sustainable aquaculture, fisheries, and fishing are the right policies for post-COVID-19 recovery efforts. This is in line with the embryo missions of understanding, protecting, and sustainable use of Indonesia's marine biodiversity for future being. Answering these issues, today on 8 to 9 August 2022, Embryo IPB University, a scientific event, international seminar on marine biodiversity, utilization and management, with the theme of fostering the health of our ocean and ensuring the sustainable marine bioresources. Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, Vice Rector of IPB University, I would like to thank the Dean of FPIK, IPB University, and of course, the organizing conference for hosting the conference. I would also like to thank all and authors for their perseverance, particularly in submitting their regard to the requirements of international publication. I now follow the steps of publication, yet I believe you all can very well. Finally, I wish you the best of luck. Thank you very much. Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh.
Waalaikumsalam warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Thank you very much, Professor Dodik Ridho Nur Rahmat, for officially opening our event today. Now that the event is officially open, we are moving on to the first main agenda of the day, which the keynote speech from the Honorable Minister of Marine Affairs and Fisheries Republic of Indonesia. So without further ado, please welcome Bapak Insinyur Sakti Wahyu Trenggono.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Selamat pagi, salam sejahtera bagi kita semua. Om Swastiastu, Namo Buddhaya, salam kebajikan. Yang saya hormati Rektor Universitas IPB, Profesor Dr. Arif Satria, Dekan Fakultas Perikanan dan Ilmu Kelautan IPB, Dr. Ferdinand Yulianda, para narasumber dan hadirin yang berbahagia. Puji syukur kita panjatkan kepada Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, Tuhan Yang Maha Esa, atas segala rahmat dan hidayah-Nya sehingga pagi ini kita dapat bersilaturahim dan dalam keadaan sehat. Potensi kelautan Indonesia sangatlah besar, lebih dari 17.500 pulau, 5,9 juta kilometer persegi wilayah perairan dan zona ekonomi eksklusif, serta ribuan spesies ikan, rumput laut dan biota terumbu karang. Lautan merupakan pusat perekonomian dan kemakmuran Indonesia ke depannya. Laut dan ekosistemnya yang sehat juga mampu memperlambat laju perubahan iklim dan mengurangi dampak bencana, seperti tsunami, naiknya permukaan laut, dan degradasi pesisir. Namun demikian, sekitar 38% perikanan Indonesia juga ditangkap secara berlebihan. Sekitar sepertiga dari terumbu karang terancam, ekosistem bakau menunjukkan kerusakan dan sampah laut merugikan negara hampir $450 juta per tahun. Melihat kondisi tersebut, Kementerian Kelautan dan Perikanan berupaya menghadirkan solusi dengan mengembangkan konsep pengelolaan perikanan berbasis ekosistem untuk penangkapan ikan melalui pengembangan penangkapan ikan terukur dengan empat aspek utama yaitu biologi, lingkungan, sosial, dan ekonomi. Keempat aspek tersebut menjadi landasan untuk mengembangkan ekonomi biru yang bertujuan antara lain efisiensi pengelolaan sumber daya alam, menyeimbangkan manfaat ekonomi dan sosial, menjaga kelestarian ekologi dan keanekaragaman hayati. Salah satu upaya menjaga kelestarian ekologi dan keanekaragaman hayati adalah dengan mengembangkan kawasan konservasi yang dikelola secara efektif untuk menjamin siklus hidup, rantai makanan, serta memberikan spillover effect dalam mendukung ketersediaan stok sumber daya ikan bagi perikanan tangkap dan perikanan budidaya laut dengan tetap mempertahankan budaya dan kearifan lokal. Pada tahun 2030, pemerintah Indonesia juga telah berkomitmen untuk membangun kawasan konservasi perairan seluas 32,5 juta hektar. Saat ini, luas kawasan konservasi perairan yang telah ada baru mencapai 28,4 juta hektar atau 8,7% dari total luas wilayah perairan nasional. Tentu ini menjadi tugas kita bersama, baik pemerintah pusat, pemerintah daerah, dan stakeholders dalam proses pencapaian target luasan kawasan konservasi maupun nanti dalam pengelolaannya. Mengingat pentingnya kawasan konservasi, maka KKP sedang merancang target penambahan luas kawasan konservasi mencapai 30% pada tahun 2045, sekaligus meningkatkan kualitas kawasan konservasi yang berkontribusi terhadap kesehatan laut dan keberlanjutan stok ikan. Pengelolaan perikanan berkelanjutan merupakan upaya untuk mengintegrasikan aspek ekologi sumber daya ikan, aspek ekonomi, dan aspek sosial. Saya yakin dengan pengintegrasian ini, perlindungan terhadap sumber daya ikan untuk menyokong hasil tangkapan yang berkualitas dan bernilai ekonomi tinggi dapat terwujud, serta terhindar dari adanya konflik sosial antara nelayan dan industri. Di samping itu, KKP saat ini sedang melaksanakan perhitungan neraca sumber daya laut untuk menjadikan salah satu indikator kesehatan lingkungan laut dan pesisir, sehingga diperlukan peran aktif pemerintah daerah untuk menyampaikan data terkait sumber daya laut yang dimiliki masing-masing provinsi. Kebutuhan akan penelitian dan kajian holistik oleh lembaga penelitian perguruan tinggi untuk mencapai target luasan kawasan konservasi, peningkatan kualitas kawasan konservasi, dan neraca sumber daya sangat diperlukan. Karena KKP telah menerapkan prinsip scientific base sebagai pertimbangan kehati-hatian dalam mewujudkan kebijakan dan peraturan pembangunan kelautan. Terima kasih. Wabillahi taufik wal hidayah. Wassalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Om Santi 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 Om.
Terima kasih Bapak Insinyur Sakti Wahyu Trenggono for an amazing speech. But before we move on to the next agenda, we are going to have a virtual certificate awarding to the Minister of Marine Affairs and Fisheries. Once again, thank you very much Bapak Sakti Wahyu Trenggono and Professor Dodi Kridono Rohmat for the speech today. Now I would like to invite all the participants to turn on your camera, because we are going to have a virtual photo session that will be led by the commit. For Mas Romdon, time is yours.
Okay, thank you. Please, for all participants, open your camera. We will take a picture. Okay. The slide one, two, three. Okay. The next slide. 1, 2, 3. Okay. The third one. 1, 2, 3. Okay. One, two, three. Okay, the next one. Okay. That's it. 1, 2, 3. One, two, three, and the last one. 1, 2, 3. Okay.
Okay, thank you, Mas Ramdan. Ladies and gentlemen, now we are moving to the next agenda, which is the first plenary session that will be delivered by two invited speakers, Professor Yoshihiro Oshie, Tohoku University, Japan, and Professor Dr. Mala Nurilmala from UB University. But before, I would like to read the short bio for our moderator, MGS Muhammad Primaputra. So, the current position is Fish Product Safety and Quality Laboratory, Department of Fisheries, Faculty of Agriculture, Universitas Gadjah Mada. So for research interests in antibacterial and the antioxidant potency, for working experience in 2022, Muhammad Prima working in the utilization of lactic acid bacteria in citrus production for 2021 in the antioxidant potency of protein hydrolysate from fisheries byproducts, and in 2020 in the antibacterial potency of bacteriocyte produced by lactic acid bacteria isolated from fisheries fermented product against histamine producing bacteria. And from the education background, Muhammad Primaputra was Bachelor of Fisheries at Department of Fisheries, Faculty of Agriculture, Universitas Gadjah Mada, Indonesia. And for the Master Science of Faculty of Agriculture Technology from Universitas Gadjah Mada, Indonesia, and also for the Doctor of Philosophy at Department of Biotechnology, Graduate School of Agriculture and Life Science, Universitas of Tokyo, Japan. Okay, so without further ado, please welcome our moderator, MGS Muhammad Primaputra.
Thank you very much, Alia, for a kind introduction. Good morning, distinguished keynote speaker, invited speakers, professors, presenters, and all participants. My name is Muhammad Prima, and it's an honor for me to become your moderator for this session. In this session, already joined with us two well-known professors in the field of fishery science. Let me say hello first to our first invited speakers, Professor Yoshihiro Oshie. Good morning, Professor.
Yes, good morning.
Ohayou gozaimasu. Kite kurete makoto ni arigatou gozaimasu. Thank you very much for coming today. Yeah. And our second invited speakers, Professor Mala Nurilmala. Good morning, Professor.
Good morning, Ms. Moderator.
It's nice to see you again here, Professor Mala. Before we start our session, I want to inform our time schedule for this morning session. Its speakers will have 30 minutes to deliver the speech, and there will be 30-minute question and answer after the second invited speaker finishes the talk. Audience can ask a question by raise hand or by fill in the form that will be shared by committee in the chat column. Without overdue, I will introduce our first invited speakers. The first invited speakers is Professor Yoshihiro Oshie. He is a professor at the Laboratory of Marine Biochemistry, Graduate School of Agricultural Science, Tohoku University. His research interest is in food science, molecular biology, and biotechnology of aquatic organisms. His working experience since 2011 and 2015, he is a professor in the School of Marine Science and Technology, Department of Fisheries, Division of Food Science, Tokai University. 2001 until 2011, he is an associate professor, Department of Aquatic Bioscience, Graduate School of Agriculture and Life Science, the University of Tokyo, Japan. And before that, in 1991 to 2001, he is an associate professor, at the Department of Education, Food Science Division, Ibaraki University. His education background, he got a doctoral degree from the University of Tokyo, Japan. Okay, without overdue, please welcome Professor Yoshihiro Ochai. Time is yours, Professor.
Thank you. So I would like to share my slides. Is it okay?
Yes, you can see clearly, Professor.
Okay. So thank you for your kind introduction, Chairperson. And good morning, ladies and gentlemen, and greetings from Japan. First, I would like to express my heartfelt thanks to the organizing committee members of this symposium. It is my great pleasure to introduce our research in this precious occasion. The topics of my talk are listed here. There are so many proteins in the muscles of fish and shellfish, so I will focus on the representative two proteins, namely tropomyosin and myoglobin. First, tropomyosin, which regulates muscle contraction and is also known as the major allergen of invertebrates, especially crustacean and mollusks, is to be characterized by molecular dynamics simulation. Secondly, amino acid substitutions, which are found in fish myoglobins, are to be characterized by their effects on the conformational stability, which is closely related with adaptation to each habitat and behavior. It has well been established that proteins are translated from messenger RNA, which has a full nucleotide sequence for the respective protein, and thus determines the amino acid sequence. The amino acid sequence determines the secondary structure, such as alpha helix. And further, the tertiary and quaternary structures. As you see, the structures of proteins are very complicated, but are closely related to their biological functions, as well as their stability, which is related with storage and processing of fish and shellfish muscles. The tertiary structures of the representative proteins from fish and shellfish muscles are shown in this slide. Namely, myosin head, tropomyosin, actin, and this is the cross section of tropomyosin. This is myoglobin and pyrrolobin. Tropomyosin, today's main cast, has a fibrous structure all over its entire molecule. Another main cast, myoglobin, is a globular protein, which is rich in alpha helix. These are the excellent model proteins owing to their unique structures. The core-to-core structure is widely found in proteins. It happens as a dimer, trimer, or tetramer. The core-to-core is formed by unique heptate repeats of seven amino acids in right places. It will be explained in detail later. This structure is present not only tropomyosin, but also in the tail region of myosin, and also in many transcription factors, which is a DNA binding proteins. The biological functions of coiled varies depending on protein species. From now on, some of the results of our research will be introduced. The background of the first topic is ingestion of marine invertebrates often causes food allergy, where the major allergens have been reported to be derived from tropomyosin, abbreviated as TM later. Intact or the digestive fragments of food allergens generally show resistance to digestion, which is usually attributable to the structural stability or rigidity. The aim of the study is as follows. The difference in the structure and the dynamical characteristics between the epitope and the non-epitope regions in tropomyosin has not yet been well understood. In this study, molecular dynamics simulation was performed at constant pHs for prone tropomyosin. The hypothesis was that the epitopes causative of allergic reactions have rigid structure and thus are resistant to proteolytic digestion. For this research, molecular dynamics, which is abbreviated as MD, which was applied to simulation, has been used to perform calculation of the extent of structure fluctuation based on the structure data from protein data bank. This method enables to estimate the structure under the conditions, which cannot be reproduced by wet or laboratory experiments. Here, the profile of a tropomyosin is described in detail. As has been introduced earlier, tropomyosin has alpha helical coil-to-coil structure over the entire molecule. This is the atomic structure of tropomyosin. This is actually the structure obtained by simulation. And this is the schematic of the cross-section of the molecule, showing the formation of heptate repeats. There are seven amino acid residues in the two chains. This is the cross-section. The strong hydrophobic interactions between the two helices and the salt bridges, which are ionic interactions, favor the conformation of the coiled coil. The simulation has been performed as described in this slide. I will not refer to the conditions in detail for now. When the alpha helix ratio was estimated, the values were found to be low at the amino and the carboxyl termini. In addition to the region around the 220th residues from the amino acid amino terminus, both for the allergic prone tropomyosin and non-allergic scallop tropomyosin. The horizontal bars correspond to the epithelial regions which cause allergy. This is the alignment of the prong and the scallop tropomyosins. On the top are shown the habitat positions to each residue as in A through F. This is a repetition of the 7 amino acid residues. The epithelial regions of prong tropomyosin are highlighted with boxes. It was revealed that the substitutions by glycine are shown in red were recognized in the fluctuated regions, which are not resistant to proteolytic digestion. Further investigations revealed that due to the ionization of the acidic residues, namely glutamic acid and aspartic acid, there were clear differences in the cumulative frequency function of pKa shift between the epitopes, and which is shown in solid line, and the non-epitope regions, which are shown in broken line. It was thus concluded that by analyzing the main chain dihedral angle fluctuation and the local alpha helix contents, the epitope regions were found to be more stable than the non-epitope counterparts, providing a possible physical reason for the resistance to digestion in the epitope regions. The difference of the structural stability between the epitope and the non-epitope regions was largest at low pH, even though pH dependence of the structural stability in itself was not significant in both regions. Then, the lower content of the alanine cluster in the epitope region is considered to cause the higher stability of the epitope region. And the next topic is the stability tuning of proteins by amino acid replacements, as can be demonstrated in fish myoglobins. This is the tertiary structure of tuna myoglobin. And the picture shows the blocks of tuna meat. As you may know, the red coloration is due to the presence of myoglobin at high concentration. And the color completely depends on the redox state of myoglobin. This is the crystal structure of yellowfin tuna myoglobin. The hen resides in the hydrophobic pocket. This is a hen. And the red part showed the helical regions, while the white regions represent the loop regions connecting the helix. Generally speaking, myoglobins are featured as follows. This is the hemoprotein of about 15 to 17 kilodaltons. It contains one heme per molecule and binds one oxygen molecule. It is highly helical, and the contents being 50 to 70%. Myoglobin is present in large amount in slow skeletal or cardiac muscles, affecting the coloration of muscle. And fish myoglobins are of great interest in diversity in stability and function and isoform composition. And lastly, some invertebrates have myoglobins with unique properties. Fish myoglobins are slightly different from their mammalian counterparts. Namely, fish myoglobins are small hemoproteins of about 147 residues, which are smaller than the mammalian counterparts by 6 to 7 residues. Thus, the pellicle content is lower, which causes the lower thermostability. And the auto-oxidation rate is also higher. And fish myoglobins tend to form aggregates because of their instability. Myoglobin is quite related to the post-mortem changes, especially of tuna muscle. After death, the pH of muscle is decreased because of the anaerobic catalysis of glycogen and the breakdown of ATP. Therefore, the meat discolors due to myoglobin oxidation. And at the same time, denaturation and decomposition of muscle proteins take place. And oxidation and hydrolysis of lipids occur. And after a while, a lot of biogenic amines are produced. These are the picture of tuna meat. This is quite fresh because of high content of reduced state of myoglobin. And this is ready to eat, rich in oxygenated myoglobin. However, when the tuna meat is left at room temperature for a long time, the myoglobin turns into the metaform and discolored like this. It is called browning. This is the alignment of the amino acid sequence of fish myoglobins based on the yellow-tailed myoglobin, including mammalian myoglobin, human and whale. The dots indicate the same residues as that of yellow-tailed myoglobin. And helical regions are contained in boxes. The red arrows indicate the histidine residues. Which are involved in oxygen binding. It is clear that there are so many substitutions of amino acids, even between fish myoglobins. And this is the phylogenetic tree drawn based on the amino acid sequences. Myoglobins from scombridae fish, such as tuna and mackerel, form one cluster. Apart from the mammalian myoglobin and Antarctic fish myoglobin, and also from Molluscan myoglobin. The table shows the sequence identity against bluefin tuna myoglobin. Fish myoglobins are contained in pink boxes. And these three are mammalian myoglobin, and the last one is the mammalian myoglobin. This is a molluscan myoglobin. So the attempts were made to unveil the instability of myoglobin causative of discoloration. There are many parameters widely used to evaluate the extent of myoglobin denaturation or conformational changes. And these are the tuna species distributed in the market. Maybe you are very familiar with this yellowfin tuna, but we Japanese like the bluefin tuna best. And the meat quality quite different among them. Myoglobins from these tuna species show clear difference in thermal stability as measured by differential scanning colorimetry. TM value is the temperature where great conformational changes take place. The higher the TM, the higher the stability. Skipjack myoglobin was found to be the most stable among the tuna myoglobins, but less stable compared with the horse myoglobin. This is a mammalian myoglobin. And the stability fluctuates depending on pH. This data show that myoglobin is most stable at around pH 6.5, slightly acidic condition. The next question is, which amino acids are involved in the stability differences? The tuna myoglobins differ only at a few residues as shown in this slide, especially the red ones. So the attempts were made to generate point mutations in tuna myoglobin and compare the stability of the recombinant proteins and to specify the responsible residues. The target residues are located in the crystal structure of myoglobin. These residues were mutated. The recombinant myoglobins with point mutations were elaborated using the plasmid PGX2T with the insert construct synthesized based on the big white tuna myoglobin sequence. In this case, the recombinant myoglobin was expressed as a fusion protein with GST or glutathione S transferase, which is a useful tag for affinity purification, and later was removed by thrombin digestion. The molecular mass of recombinant myoglobin, these are the SDS page patterns of recombinant myoglobin, which had the right size as determined by the MALDI-TOF mass spectrometry. The final results is here. The stabilities of the mutant myoglobins were measured by circular dichroism spectrometry. Wild type, as shown in blue, stands for the wild type or big-eyed tuna myoglobin. When the temperature was raised, the molar elasticity tended to increase for all the myoglobins. But when compared with the wild type, the stability of the mutant A49G, for example, was clearly reduced, while the mutant of H112Q was clearly increased. Therefore, only one substitution of amino acid was found to cause dramatic difference in the stability of myoglobin. So the conclusions are shown in the figure and table. There could be a difference of tuna myoglobins in their thermal stability was due to a single amino acid substitution. Such substitutions are considered to have been acquired through their evolution as well as adaptation to restrictive habitats and behaviors. And that's all. Thank you for your kind attention.
Thank you very much, Professor Achiai, for a very interesting talk about this muscle protein. It's really interesting.
Thank you very much.
Audience here have a lot of questions about the muscle protein. Thank you, Professor. And then, ladies and gentlemen, we will move to our second invited speaker. She is Professor Mala Nurilmala. Good morning, Professor Mala.
Good morning, Mr. Prima.
It's nice to see you here again. Before I will introduce Professor Mala. So Professor Mala Nurilmala is a Vice Dean in the IPB and the Faculty of Fisheries and Marine Science. And besides the Vice Dean, Professor Mala is also Head of Laboratory of Fisheries Biomolecular Laboratory. He is also a freelance editor for LPPM MUI for Halal Food, also an editor in Indonesian Fisheries Processing Journal. She is also Secretary General at Indonesian Society for Fish Processing Technology and also Head of Division on Halal Research Science Center IPB. So Professor Mala, you also have 30 minutes and the time is yours.
Okay, thank you. Can you see my slide?
Yes, Prof. Mala.
Okay, good morning, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank Committee of Embryo International Seminar for inviting me as one of the speakers. And thanks also for moderator to nice introducing me. I'm happy that I can meet my professor here, Professor Yoshihiro Ochiai, in a Zoom meeting. And today I will share part of our research topic regarding the valorization of fishery waste, potency and challenges on future product development in Indonesia. So as we see in the slide here, we live in Indonesia. And as we know that Indonesia is a tropical country, based on its geographical location, Indonesia is located between two continents here and also two oceans, namely the continents of Asia and Australia, and also two oceans, namely Indian Ocean and Pacific Ocean. So Indonesia also is known as archipelagic country, which is 70% of Indonesian territory is water. And we have the mega biodiversity, which huge marine and fisheries resources. So in our country, in Indonesia, also in the world, I think we have some economical fish such as tuna. As we know that tuna, the main product is the meat. The meat can be produced as loin and also for canning or frozen food. But in other hand, we found also the number of waste is about 40%, including skin, viscera, fins, head, and bones, as you can see in this picture. And another fish such as eel, this is also very famous in Japan or also in Indonesia also. The fish is eel or unagi or sidat in Indonesian language, with the main product is about 50 or 60%, but we found that other product is fishery byproduct, including head, also liver, viscera, trimming, and bones. And for another fish, the freshwater fish, such as red tilapia. Red tilapia also, we found that the main product, the meat, and other products such as fin, skin, scale is about 50%. Here also, you can see the pangasius product in Indonesia and also in the world. I think the pangasius production tend to increase year by year. And the main product is about 30 to 40%. And the fishery byproduct, including bone, skin, also the viscera, is about 50 to 60%. So very high fishery byproduct in pangasius. And generally, the utilization of the fishery byproduct is traditional processing, such as fish snack and cracker for skin. And for bones, it can be used as a feed. And also another part, we in Indonesia, we just utilize for feed. So for increasing the added value product, our team tried to process this fishery byproduct to be collagen-based product and hydrolyzed product and enzyme, also fish oil and glucosamine. In this slide, we can see the collagen explanation. So actually, there are some protein in the fish body, such as sarcoplasmic and myofibril protein. And collagen is connective tissue protein. And collagen make up about 30% of total muscle protein. And totally, the most highest protein in the body is collagen, is about 30%. And in the fish, collagen can be found in the skin, bone, scale, and swim bladder. And we also can explain that the location of the collagen is in the cellular location in the extracellular matrix, with the structure triple helix, and the function of the collagen can contribute to the stability of tissue and organs. And to maintain the structural integrity, and collagen has great tensile strength. And in the collagen, it has the main amino acid such as glycine, comprises about 33% of amino acid. And in this collagen, we can find the three alpha chain, which is the each of the alpha chain contain 1,000 amino acid or 100 kilodalton of the molecular weight. So in the collagen also, it contain the hydroxyproline amino acid, and the hydroxyproline acid amino acid contribute to the stabilization of the collagen. And in the fish collagen, sometimes we can find the low hydroxyproline content. And here actually we can find there are some types of collagen. And in the fish skin, mainly the type of collagen is type 1. And type 2 we can find in the cartilage. So we will explain another collagen conversion, namely gelatin. Gelatin come from the Greek words geler, the meaning is gelling. So gelatin is water-soluble protein, and it is natural polymer from thermal denaturation or partially degradation of collagen. Here in from fish, we can found in the bone, connective tissue, scale, swim bladder, also in animal skin. So as you can see here in the picture, that our body also contain the highest protein in collagen is about 30%, and then the structure triple helix in the collagen, and with the denaturation by heating, the collagen will be converted to the gelatin with the little bit different in the structure. And here, actually, to convert gelatin, we can use two types, namely type A and type B. Type A, it means the process can be produced by acid hydrolysis, and type B, we can produce with the basic hydrolysis. So that is the difference between type A and type B. Here in this picture, I just want to explain to you that the conventional sources of collagen and gelatin product, actually, as we found in the information here, that the global gelatin market by raw material still domination by the non-halal raw material. So we can find here that about 42% collagen and gelatin-based product were found from a skin of the porcine, and followed by the skin of the bovine and bone from porcine and bovine. So in the other hand, the world halal product business value also increase year by year. So we have to find the alternative of the conventional of the raw material of collagen and gelatin. As you can see here in this slide, that the collagen gelatin in Indonesia until now generally come from import. And the information that we got, that the import trend to increase also. However, as I explained previously, that the conventional collagen gelatin come from porcine and also bovine. So some problem in bovine, we can know, like foot and mouth disease, also in Indonesia also is now getting popular, and also for virus for flu from porcine. And also in Indonesia, we have the constitution regarding the halal certificate mandatory. So we try to develop the collagen gelatin raw material to fulfill the requirement of collagen and gelatin Indonesia. And we try to develop from a fishery product such as skin, bones, and swim bladder, also from the scale, like in this slide. So we try to develop from some economical fish in Indonesia, like from seawater fish and from freshwater fish. Here, like bone, swim bladder, scale, and skin. And so as you see here, in collagen position, in fish skin, you can see with the dark color in the picture. This is from sea bass, from Nile or red tilapia, and also from pangasius and from tuna. So this utilization also can meet with the principle in the industry. The namely of the principle is zero waste principle in fishery industry. Here, the collagen extraction that we develop, there are some method to extract the collagen, such as acidic method, enzymatic method, and combination between acidic and enzymatic method. So here, as you can see, we try to extract the collagen from the skin of the tuna. And this also, we also try to extract the collagen from tuna with the method of the combination between acidic and enzymatic enzymatic method. And the result is very effective if you extract the collagen with the method, with the combination between acidic and enzymatic method. So here the SDS page pattern, you can see the molecular weight of the collagen extraction with some enzymatic method. And we found here that our collagen is belong to the type 1. As we can see here, there are alpha 1, alpha 2, and a beta. And we also can find the infrared spectrum of collagen here. We found some specific area indicator for collagen. For gelatin extraction, actually, there are some steps to extract gelatin, including preparation, extraction, and purification. Here, we develop the gelatin extraction from skin, such as tuna, angasius, and tilapia. And we also try to optimize the extraction with some method, and we successfully found the method to optimize the extraction. So this is the reaction when the collagen to be gelatin. It is involving the denaturation with the heating process. So as the result for collagen and gelatin, actually collagen, gelatin, here we can find in the muscle also, and with the denaturation, it will be convert to the gelatin. And from collagen and gelatin, we also can make a peptide collagen, or also can be can we know as the peptide or active collagen. So this collagen-based product is very useful in many industries such as food and non-food also. So here the difference between native collagen, gelatin, and collagen peptide. As you can see here, the native collagen still in the structure is still the triple helix, and the properties of this native collagen is insoluble in the water. And gelatin also the structure in the single or double helix, and collagen peptide in the structure. And for the properties of solubility in the water, gelatin is soluble in the warm water, and collagen is very easy to be dissolved. So as I explained to you that collagen or gelatin also still the main amino acid are glycine, proline, and hydroxyproline to make it the meal strength is very high. So in the market, we can find some product based on collagen and gelatin here. The product can be very easy, we can find. And also for the biomaterial, now the utilization of the collagen and gelatin-based product also increased to in biomaterial biomaterial function. So this is also the properties of the our tuna skin collagen. So as we know that in previously, we said that the main amino acid is glycine, proline, and hydroxyproline. And this is the indicator of the functional group of our tuna skin gelatin with the specific of the wavelength. And this is the appearance of tuna skin waste, and the proportion is about 5 to 80%. And this is the appearance of our collagen and gelatin from tuna, and with the enzymatic hydrolysis and or acidic or base hydrolysis, we can make it to be peptide. So our peptide can enhance the functional properties such as the antioxidant. This is the properties of our molecular weight of collagen, gelatin, and its peptide here. As you can see, our type of the collagen and gelatin also have the similar in the molecular weight or molecular weight. And after the enzymatic hydrolysis, we got the peptide or active collagen, which is indicating with the law of the molecular weight, as you can see in this slide. We also try to explore the antioxidant activity of collagen-based product from tuna. As you can see here, we investigated the collagen and gelatin with and without hydrolysis. As you can see here, actually, after we made it to be peptide, so the antioxidant activity getting trend to increase with the antioxidant activity. So here also the IC50 of our collagen, gelatin, and hydrolyzed protein, the rank of the IC50 is about strong to very strong antioxidant. So it's mean our collagen, gelatin, and peptide is very good to be antioxidant activity. Here also we try to develop the collagen peptide from pangasius skin as antioxidant, and also for also the you can see also the similar pattern of the skin from pangasius as the tuna. So here also we try to develop the fish skin to be gelatin, for example from pangasius, tilapia, and tuna, as you can see here, and also from swim bladder and from the scale, and the gelatin properties still fulfill the requirement of the standard of Indonesia, such as SNI and a standard from USA, such as GMIA. So you can see here the pattern of our molecular weight of gelatin also is similar among from fishery byproducts. Now we try to discuss regarding the application collagen-based product here. As a summary that marine collagen, so many paper that found and reported that there are many function in marine collagen, such as for bioactive properties such as antioxidant, skin anti-aging, antimicrobial, antihypertensive, and wound healing activities. So the advantage also, the four marine collagen is very easy to extract, and the marine collagen is water solubility, and marine collagen now getting to increase the utilization for biomaterial such as for scaffold, carriers, foods, and cosmetic. And the safety, the marine collagen no risk in transformance of genetic disease. And there is no religious barrier and low production cost. So this is the right site for the gelatin utilization application. So gelatin application actually is highest for food and followed by pharmaceutical and others. Here we can see that the function of gelatin in the food as a gelling agent, as a stabilizer, and also for emulsifier, as well as for binder agent. Also for the cosmetic, we can found in the product such as a lotion, shampoo, skincare, also now for mask, for soap, and also for another utilization, for example, film photography and biodegradable packaging. Let me explain another our products here. We developed the blackhead mask for clean the blackhead in our nose area. So we developed from collagen-based product, And this is very effective to clean our blackhead around our nose. So the characterization of this product, warm water soluble and neutral pH, and also very easy to be dried. So the benefit our mask gelatin here to solve the problem of comedo and also help removing the skin cell, and our skin gets smooth in the skin. We also developed the collagen and gelatin based product in the pharmacy industry for hard capsule materials. And this is the capsule properties, and the capsule properties also meet the requirement of the standard in our standard in Indonesia. So this is also another application for gelatin in the film bio nanocomposite. So we developed the packaging with the C-dot as the filler as a nanocomposite. And finally, this packaging increase the mechanical properties with nanocomposite and increase thermal properties, and also for show the photoluminescence. This is the appearance of the our packaging with the nanocomposite, as you can see here. So we found that our biofilm, smooth and transparent film, and also film emitting green-blue color emission if we add with the C-dot. And C-dot has been successfully added to the film to increase the mechanical properties of our packaging. So this is also for the another properties of the film. So with the nanocomposite, we can reduce or we can allow the WVTR properties. For the biomaterial, as you can see here, the marine derived collagen is very popular now. And why we use the MDC or marine derived collagen? Because of the good biocompatibility properties, also biodegradable, and also have the low antigenicity as well as the low toxicity. So the marine derived collagen is very suitable for repair tissue and organ damage. So this is the function of MDC in as a biomaterial for controlling release of protein or hormones, also for burn wound healing and increased drug bioavailability, and also can be used as a tumor treatment. And this MDC also have the pH sensitive drug release. This is also we are developing the MDC to wound healing product. So collagen will act as a bioactive biomimetic carrier that regulates the wound healing process. And collagen can increase the proliferation of fibroblast cell and accelerate the rate of the wound closure with a high rate of the degradation. And also MDC also now is developed to be scaffold. Scaffold is a biomaterial that facilitates more regular growth and formation of new bone tissue. Actually, a scaffold, as naturally, we can find from collagen, gelatin, elastin, and chitosan. And this is for from the synthetic. So this is some report already reported that the marine derived collagen is very wide to be biomaterial. And also the collagen peptide also, as I explained before. And another also we developed byproduct from eel. So actually the eel is a fishery byproduct of eel has the low economic value, and we try to increase with the processing with the protein hydrolysate. And this is the result of the hydrolysate protein from the fishery byproduct of eel, which is the hydrolyzed product. We added some enzyme here. And as you can see, the molecular weight of the hydrolyzed product is getting lower before compared with before addition of the enzyme to low our molecular weight. So our research team also in our university and in another institute also developed regarding the fungaceous fish skill, fungaceous fish oil, I mean, sorry. And now we try to make it efficient of this product. And here also we also developed the pepsin isolation from tuna byproduct. This is the group of our team also in our university. So we try to isolate the stomach of tuna and then isolated it to be a pepsin. And then we get the pepsin purification. And also this is the appearance of our pepsin enzyme, which is in the form liquid and also in the powder form. So we also try to develop the byproduct of shrimp to be glucosamine, which is glucosamine also plays a vital role in building and repairing cartilage. So that's all many fishery byproduct still in developing until now. And I think that's all my presentation. Thank you very much. And I give to the Prima. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Mala. Very interesting talk this morning. I think I also need to use the collagen mask for my face, I think. Thank you, Professor Mala. Okay, audience. I see we still have 246 audience here. For those who have a question, please raise your hand. And also you can also write your question through the Slido. The link is on the chat. So please, audience, is there any? There's a lot of researcher. I saw some researcher from abroad and also researcher from Indonesia also. Is there any question? You can raise your hand and also write your question. Okay, while waiting from the audience, I will try to make a question for Professor Achai. Sorry, Professor.
Yes.
Yeah, it's really interesting to see how you change the amino acid and the protein. Can we know further the basic how you choose which amino acid should be replaced? And also maybe you can also explain how you insert the plasmid. I don't have any experience in the fish cell. Maybe you can kindly explain to us, Professor. Thank you.
Actually, we use E. coli bacteria.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. And we are lucky because the molecular size of myoglobin was small compared to the other proteins. The molecular size is around 1.5 kilodaltons. So it is quite a small protein. So it was relatively easy to make the mutants.
Oh, sorry, Professor. So you do this in recombinant protein?
Right.
Ah, okay. Thank you. Thank you very much, Professor, for the explanation. And also, can you explain how to choose which amino acid should be replaced, Professor?
The reason why I pick up some
how to choose the amino acids.
Because as shown in the slides, we compare the amino acid sequence.
Okay.
And only a few amino acids were substituted among the tuna myoglobins.
Okay.
So it was also quite easy to pinpoint the location of the mutation.
Okay.
Understand?
Yeah, very clear, Professor. Thank you very much for your answer. Okay, audience, is there any question? Committee, is there a question through the link? Not yet. I saw some researchers from Aceh. Good morning. From Diponegoro, Semarang. From Brin. Good morning. Okay.
Actually, I share a lot with Dr. Mala. We're focusing on fish proteins. And we work together for a long time.
I also see a very interesting fact today because Chai Sensei and Professor Mala graduated from the University of Tokyo. Yeah, and I also graduated from the University of Tokyo.
We were in the same lab.
Okay. Yes, it's really, yeah, it's really interesting, Professor. Mr. Rani Nugraha, raise hand. You can open mic. Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Please mention your institution and also for who your question is.
Okay. Thank you so much for the opportunity. My name is Rani Nugraha. I'm from Department of Aquatic Product Ecology, together with Professor Mala Nurimala. I would like to ask a question to Professor Ochie regarding the tropomyosin and also another allergenic protein from seafood, such as papabumin. We know that tropomyosin is also available, or we can found in human and also other mammals' muscle, similar with the papabumin also. However, we know that only tropomyosin from shellfish, like a shrimp, mollusk, or the lobster, contain allergenic or possess allergenic activity, but not in mammals. Similar with the papabumin as well. Is there any reason in the structural context why tropomyosin or papabumin have allergenic activity, while the counterpart from mammals don't have allergenic activity? Thank you. I think that's my question. Thank you so much.
Yeah, very good question. Another reason for the allergenicity of crustacean tropomyosin is that it is quite soluble in water, unlike the mammalian counterparts. So the soup of shrimp contains a lot of solubilized tropomyosin. That is another reason. See? So if you take soup, or even the vapor contains tropomyosin. So some sensitive people get allergic to crustacean tropomyosin. Just one mouth or just a touch of to the soup. You understand? Solubility is quite different among crustacean and mammalian tropomyosins.
Is it clear, Mr. Roni?
Okay, meaning that tropomyosin from mammals doesn't have a good solubility in water.
Yeah, low solubility.
Okay.
So stays in myofiber even after cooking.
Mm.
And also you talked about the papabumin.
Yeah.
It is quite a small protein and quite soluble in water.
Mm.
So the reason may be the same for the crustacean tropomyosin and papabumin. Solubility.
Okay. Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Professor Chai. We have a question in the Slido. I will read the question from Krishna from IPB. I would like to ask to Professor Mala, how is gelatin formulated with nanocellulose as biomaterial for wound dressing or healing? Please, Professor Mala.
Yeah, okay, Mr. Prima, thanks for the nice question. So I want to say hello, Ochiai Sensei. So very long time we don't meet each other. I think now we meet in online Zoom meeting. Oh. Sensei wa ogenki desu ka?
Genki desu. Before the COVID, I frequently visited Indonesia.
Yeah. So because Ochiai Sensei is regularly a visit to Indonesia, Prima. So since 2020, so he didn't visit Indonesia, I think.
Due to COVID.
So yeah, Primo also is graduated from Todai Sensei. Now he is in the Gama University in Gajah Mada University in the similar lab with us. So thank you for the question. As I explained to you that. Now gelatin is getting for utilization, for example, as a biomaterial, as a biomaterial. So for biomaterial, we can use also for wound healing. So there are some experiment actually, not only gelatin solely, but also we can add some like cellulase or also chitosan. And now, but unfortunately, until now, we haven't yet tried to add the gelatin with the cellulase prima. So, but in the previous report, some of the experiment already tried that not only gelatin for biomaterial in the application, but also we can add some like cellulase, also chitosan and also another seaweed. That's all, Prima.
Thank you, Professor Mala. We have another question to Professor Mala from I think also Krishna about the collagen. If we eat the collagen and the collagen become broken in our digestion, is there still activity? Thank you.
Yeah, it's very nice and important question. So as you know, that collagen is the big structure. So that's why the very easy to be dissolved in our body is a collagen peptide actually. So if we want to get more effective the function in our body, so my suggestion is consume collagen product in the collagen peptide. Because as I explained to you, the molecular weight in the collagen peptide is smaller than collagen and gelatin. So it will be effective in a human body. That's all, Prima.
Thank you very much, Professor Mala. The next question is for Professor Ochiai. You mentioned that protein is soluble in the water, easily soluble. Do you? It means that we can just wash the shrimp and then the allergenic protein will be washed out. Is it correct, Professor?
Yes, it is possible to wash out tropomyosin after slight heated treatment. So you can remove tropomyosin for those allergic to crustacea. Yes.
Okay, thank you very much for the firm answer. So audience, is there any other question? You can raise hand or write your question in the link that already provided by the committee. Okay, we have another question for, again, Professor Mala. Are there some challenge in producing collagen from fisheries byproduct? Please, Professor Mala.
Yeah, of course, because as we talked about before, we discussed before that in fishery byproduct, for example, we found skin, swim bladder, or also bone. So naturally, the portion of the like skin and also bone and also swim bladder, they have the high content of the collagen. For example, in the skin, we can find the collagen content is about 80%. So with the highest proportion of the collagen in the skin, we can make it to extract the collagen, and also we can process to collagen peptide also as well as the gelatin. And the advantage of the collagen, because in Indonesia, most of Indonesian people are Muslim, so we are very important to think about the halal regarding the halal definition in Indonesia, because as we know that conventional collagen and gelatin products, so the most and the conventional raw material are from reported are from porcine and bovine. I also have many research with Ojia Sensei developing the collagen and gelatin based product. So it is very possible to develop collagen from a fishery byproducts. Thanks very much. So
thank you, Professor Mala. We have another question. He didn't mention his name, to Professor Ojiai. So the question is, in Indonesia, there are a lot of food processing that using fermentation that this might be hydrolyzed the protein. Is this fermentation process also can reduce the allergic protein, Professor?
Maybe, yes, but the epitope regions are resistant to digestion. So some of them may remain.
So the hydrolysis is not the way to remove.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, thank you, Professor Chiang. Okay, there is also another question to Professor Mala. Unfortunately, this is also no Nemos. So Professor Mala, you mentioned that you make a product from the chitin. Yeah, can you explain more on about the product that may be also already produced based on the chitin, Professor?
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Moderator. So actually now we also developing product from fishery byproduct, namely from shrimp, because in the shrimp, it still contain chitin in the shell. We try to develop the glucosamine actually based on the chitin and chitosan product. So for the audience, maybe if you want to ask more detail, we can ask. Actually, there are some methods to make it to be chitin first, and then after that, we can convert to the chitosan, and after some treatment, we also can get the chitosan. That is the common methods for the glucosamine. So like collagen gelatin also, glucosamine also is the supplement now. It's very important for our healthy of our bones. And we also know that in Indonesia, also in the world, I think, the problem also we can found with the bone healthy. So the glucosamine from shrimp, fishery of byproduct of shrimp can be made to glucosamine with the conversion from the chitosan. Thank you, Prima.
Thank you, Professor Mala. Another question again to Professor Mala. Okay, this time there is a name from Johanna, Mrs. Johanna. From Brim to Professor Mala, marine collagen product has lower price than freshwater fish. Why and how many is the ratio? Product has lower price. Lower price. Okay. The question is, okay, once more time, Professor Mala. Marine collagen product has lower price than freshwater fish. Why and how many is the ratio?
So I think there is the opinion. I don't agree with the opinion.
Is it true? or maybe opposite.
No. Actually, in the market, marine derived collagen, the higher is higher more than the conventional collagen or gelatin. Compare with the bovine or porcine. So it is, the opinion is not true, I think. So the statement that the collagen-based product from marine derived collagen, the price is higher more than bovine or porcine.
Oh, how if we compare to the freshwater, Professor Mala?
Diulangin ya lagi. Coba kamu.
Sorry, Mrs. Esther Rohina.
Sama. Udah tugas dikerjain.
Sorry yes. For the noise.
So actually in the market, the collagen from both marine or freshwater fish, the price is higher than porcine or bovine collagen product.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, thank you very much, Professor Mala. Okay, the next question still for Professor Mala from Dr. Charles PH Simanjuntak. So a marine derived collagen or MDC can be extracted from fish waste product, which is an economical and sustainable source for collagen. Do you have any data of the collagen production that origin from fish processing industries as waste product in Indonesia and from which area? Please, Rosamala.
Okay, thank you for the director of our embryo. So, Dr. Charles, this is the nice question. So we already try to develop collagen from some fish, for example, from marine fish such as tuna, sea bass, and also in Indonesia, kakatua. And also from other freshwater fish such as tilapia and also pangasius. So as we already explore, there are similar properties of them among freshwater and marine seawater. So we develop from many areas such as around Bogor also. We also try to explore the raw material from Medan, from also from the East Java. So we already try, and then we have compared each other the raw material original from that area. And fortunately, we found there are no similar significant the properties raw material from different area. So we have some data for that. And then actually, this is I think very important if we try to develop the raw material from fishery byproduct to increase the added value, because until now the utilization of this product is not high, it is not optimal. I mean, it's just like the traditional, like only fish skin crackers, and also maybe like for feed. So we hope that if we develop the added value products, so the high, the price of this raw material will increase, and also we'll get the added value products. That's all.
Thank you, Professor Mala. So Dr. Charles also asked the second question. Until now, we don't have any collagen industry in big scale. What is the main reason? And can we build one?
Yeah, maybe this is different between Indonesia and Japan, also other country in the world. Because conventional raw material in the world, as I explained before, come from skin from porcine or a bovine. And in Indonesia, it is not possible if we develop from porcine raw material. But in Indonesia, if we develop the raw material from bovine skin or bones, it's very difficult because, like Prima also maybe, and also Pak Charles, it is the skin and bone of the bovine is very popular in Indonesia to be eaten, like in the rumah makan Padang, okay, as a tunjang or as a kikil. So yeah, it will have the problem with the continuitas of the raw material if we develop the collagen come from skin or bone of bovine. That's all. That's why the reason.
Thank you very much, Professor Amala. The next question for Professor Ochiai. I think this is from student. So this is not related to the context, but he or she asks, do you accept a master's student, Professor?
I'm sorry, I'm going to retire.
Oh, okay. Okay, so maybe it's difficult.
Please follow Professor Mala.
Okay.
So actually, Ochiai Sensei already graduated to Indonesian student in master student, Ochiai Sensei.
Okay.
And before, Ochiai Sensei also accepted some student from Indonesia as the exchange student.
Okay.
But maybe next year, Sensei will be retired, right?
Oh,
yes.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
Okay, Professor, thank you. So still to Professor Ochiai, the next question, I think is also anonymous, but he or she like a sushi. So the question is, why is sushi so special with tuna? Can other fish beside tuna use as sushi food?
any fresh fish can be on the top of sushi.
Okay.
Yeah, any fish. Yeah, we Japanese utilize various kinds. So, yeah, you have a good collection of fish species. So,
thank you.
please try other species.
Yeah, thank you very much, Professor Ochiai. So, this is regarding the Japanese culture, not regarding to the topic. Sorry, Professor. Okay, the next question is to Professor Mala from Andianto, from Brin. So I have a question to Professor Mala, which is better for our health, collagen from fish that live alive from the sea water or from the fresh water?
Yeah, thank you for the question. And as I explained before in our data, so there is no significant the properties from marine or fresh water. So we can consume or we can use both fresh water or marine derived collagen. So because there is no difference significant between them.
So still the same, okay.
Yeah.
Thank you very much, Professor Mala. Still for Professor Mala, I think this is also from Anonymous. What is the minimum fat limit in gelatin made from pangasius skin?
Okay, so there are some standard of the fat in the collagen or gelatin. So we can find, for example, in SNI, Standard National Indonesia, and also for standard from USA. So for the general standard for the fat, so it should be lower than 1%. So we can use for this gelatin in our food and other non-food industry.
Okay, thank you very much, Professor. Okay, we have one raised hand from the audience, from Fanny Krista, Politeknik AP.
Yeah, hello. Yeah, okay. Thank you. Yes. Okay. I'm Fanny Krista. I'm one of the lecturer in Politeknik Kelautan Perikanan Jembrana. I have a question for Miss Mala, Nuriel Mala. Thank you so much for your presentation. Actually, it's kind of interesting to talk about collagen. And I have a question, like, there are many procedures of collagen extraction, right? But then I have a question, which procedures can get a good activity or a good bioactivity of collagen? Because I think the reason we want to extract the collagen because we want to gain the functional activity, right? But then which procedures can actually get the best activity for the extraction? Okay, thank you, Ms. Mala. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Please, Professor Mala.
Okay, thank you for the question. So you have question which one the best method for the collagen extraction, right? So in our experience, we developed some methods, for example, acidic method and enzymatic method. And from our experiences, we found that the combination of the acidic method and enzyme method get the good result, for example, in the antioxidant and also for the yield and another properties. So I suggest to you, if you want to develop the collagen extraction from fish, so you can try combination between acidic and enzyme. So the enzyme, you can choose some enzyme, for example, trypsin, pepsin, or also from plant. We also, together with OGI-sensei, already try to use the plant enzyme from, for example, papain and also bromelain. So that's all my answer.
So thank you, Prahmala. Is it clear?
Yeah, thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you. So, oh, still, the next question is still to Professor Mala from Anonymous. So I would like to ask, does consume fish collagen supplement can cause weight gain? Please, Professor Mala.
Yeah, I think not only. Yeah. Yeah, actually collagen, the function, the dominant function for our skin. So not for reducing the weight of body. Yeah.
Okay.
So if you consume the collagen or collagen peptide, so will affect efficiently with your skin and also the health of your bones. So okay. Not for the reducing the weight of the body. Thank okay. you.
Thank you, Professor Mala. And okay, I have an information that Professor Ochai a little bit busy. So we have to finish our discussion in 10:45. So we still have 10 minutes left. So for those who have a question, please, you can raise your hand, and also you can as in Indonesia language, if you have a limitation in English, so we can translate it to English, or maybe directly translate to Japanese by Professor Mala, or you can just write your question in the Slido link in the chat. Okay, we have an anonymous question to Professor Ochiai. So besides, regarding the allergic protein, Professor, besides have an allergic effect, can we utilize this protein to become a protein that have a bioactivity protein? Is it possible, Professor Chen?
You mean to convert streptomycin to some bioactive?
Yeah, yeah.
Maybe yeah, it's possible because most of the proteins show some bio functions after digestion, but we are not sure about the how much okay. the tropomyosin is effective after digestion.
Okay. Thank you very much, Professor Ochai. Okay, we have another question to Professor Mala again from Anonymous. I want to know which one is better, the raw material from sea fish or fresh water fish. I think this is the same, not the same question. So I think, yeah, Professor Mala can answer quickly.
Yeah, Prima can answer also, yeah. I already answered, yeah.
Yeah,
yeah, in our experience, there is no similar significant the properties between freshwater and seawater. That's okay. All my answer.
Okay, thank you very much, Professor Mala. Okay, audience, we still have it increased to 263. Is there any question? You can raise your hand or write your question in the Slido. Is there any other question? Okay, from Dr. Charles, rise hand, please.
Thank you very much. I have a question to Ochiai Sensei. Hi, Ochiai Sensei, thank you very much for your nice presentation.
You're welcome.
Sensei, in Indonesia, we have so many unexplored deep sea fish. And in your review paper, you mentioned that similar situation with the deep sea fish with the elasmobranchs. So my question is, for us, for Indonesian researchers, do you have any, the suggestion to us to study about the, maybe for the, not only muscle, but probably another compound from the deep sea fish? I believe you have any data regarding that. So please, could you, encourage us to study about deep sea fish in Indonesia regarding your topic today. Thank you very much, Sensei.
Deep sea fish, maybe through the adaptation to the environment, they may have some special substances which are involved in the adaptation to high hydraulic pressure. So it is quite interesting because you have a lot of deep sea fish species. So it is worth to explore the unexplored species. Maybe you can find some interesting or useful substances.
Yeah, in Gindara, Sensei? Gindara.
It's an escala or an oldfish.
Okay, thank you very much, Sensei.
You're welcome.
Thank you, Mr. Prima.
Thank you very much, Dr. Charles. So, we still have 7 minutes before we close our session. Is there any other question? Maybe last question? Okay, the last idea from Mr. Ronnie. So please.
Okay, maybe last question in the session.
Yeah.
Maybe to Prof. Ochiai and also Prof. Mala. I think recently there is a report talking about collagen as a major allergen among Japanese people. Is there any specific reason why Japanese people have kind of allergen to collagen? Maybe they use a lot of collagen in the cosmetic or something like that. And to Dr. Mala, and how to reduce the allergenicity of collagen in your product, Dr. Mala. Thank you. I think that's the question.
Yeah. Okay. Let me ask the first question. Maybe we take a lot of collagen as in food and cosmetics, and we are exposed to fish collagen so frequently. Maybe that is the reason. Most of many Japanese are very sensitive to collagen. And Dr. Mala, please.
Yes, Sensei, he is an expert in the allergen, Sensei. Dr. Ronnie is expert in the allergen.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
No wonder.
Yeah, why I mean Japanese people so allergic to collagen because I think this is just a recent report coming from Japanese author, and we didn't know why there's so many legendation.
Maybe another reason is the environment.
Yeah.
Or pollution.
Pollution.
Yeah. Maybe.
Is it possible with the genetic differences between Japanese people and others?
I'm not sure about that.
Yeah, because in Indonesia until now, I don't have any data reported that collagen making allergy for Indonesian people. But in just exploration with previous paper that the collagen make the allergen for the Japanese people. So Indonesia, I don't know, maybe there is no report or there is no case. I'm not sure about that. Yeah, so that's why now we are trying with Dr. Roni to develop how to reduce the allergen source if the collagen has the if the collagen has the allergen has the allergen. So but for the gelatin, maybe because of the conversion of the collagen, not native collagen, we can reduce by heating. So I think our experiment by heating the allergen can be reduced with the heating or maybe addition of the chemical or washing with the water. So because some of the allergen also can be found from the protein water soluble protein, right? So that's all, Mr. Roni.
Okay, thank you so much, Itumala. And thank you so much for
Chai. You're welcome.
So thank you very much for, I think this is the last question for this session. Yeah, I'm sure there are still more questions from audience, but unfortunately we are running out of time. For those who are interested in Professor Ochiai and Professor Ma's work, you can make a personal contact after this international seminar. So dear all participants, we have arrived at the end of the session. First and foremost, I would like to express my appreciation to the invited speakers for their valuable contribution. I hope that the discussion that we have been made here will continue in the near future. Thank you very much again for your attention. I'm sorry for any mistake or inconvenience I made during this session. Good morning, and I give back to Masters of Ceremony. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you, Sensei Sasiburi Sensei.
Thank you very much for our moderator and guest, and also for Professor Yoshihiro Osire and Professor Mala Nuriumala for their amazing knowledge and experience on us. Next, we're going to have a virtual certificate awarding. First is for Professor Yoshihiro Osire, is awarded as invited speaker. And the second one is for Professor Mala Nuriumala, is awarded as invited speaker. And last for MGS Muhammad Prima Putra, is awarded as moderator. Thank you so much once again.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, the next agenda is parallel session, but before we start the session, we would like to show you a glance of embryo as a research of excellence under the Faculty of Fisheries and Marine Science. This video shows the journey of embryo since its establishment in 2014 until now. So please enjoy the video. Oh, Ladies and gentlemen, due to the pandemic COVID-19, since 2019, most of embryo activity was conducted online. Of course, we all miss offline activities that we used to have years ago. So there's also a flashback video. So please enjoy the video. Thank you. MDO wouldn't be at this point without inspiring initiators. So in this moment, we will take a short time to pray for one of the embryo initiators, Dr. Hawis Madupa. May he rest in peace. Now is parallel session one. So for the participants, please move to the meeting room A, B, C, D, or E. Detailed information about the presentation in each room can be found in the program book. The parallel session one will be last for 1 hour. After that, the participants will have lunch break until 1 p.m. And then we will start the parallel session two at 1 p.m. So please be back to the main room at the p.m. So now all the participants can move to the parallel session. Thank you.